Greetings and welcome back to our Talks with Walt, as we are calling our readings through the deathbed edition of Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass. We turn now to The Singer in the Prison, a three-part little poem, poem number 10 of the 38 of Autumn Rivulets. We have commented already that autumn representing that which is kind of old, maybe we would say ancient, and rivulets that which is new. We're going to ask, why would a poem like this end up in a collection called Autumn Rivulets? And I think we'll have a couple of ideas later on after we've read the poem. Now, our assumptions are that you've been following our stuff at learnstrong.net, down that left-hand side, Talks with Walt is our playlist. And we've worked with everything from inscriptions, you'll remember, to a certain Contrecce that we've already commented on, where Alboni, the great opera is going to be celebrated there. Music was, as we've pointed out so many times in our conversations, music so important for Whitman, and we're going to play that game here as well. We did give a set of introductory comments to Autumn Rivulets, and as well, we just finished with Prudence. Now, our background information through our Nortons will tell us that this poem was first published in the Saturday Evening Visitor, Washington, December 25th, 1869, before inclusion in the 1871 Passage to India and succeeding editions of Leaves of Grass. In the present text, 1881, Whitman excluded the two-line refrain after the first canto and each quatrain of the hymn. The poem, to continue now with Norton, celebrates the 1869 concert of the famous singer Pepira Rosa in Sing Sing Prison, a performance said to have been attended by the poet himself. This is one of the few poems in Leaves of Grass, Norton finishes, inspired by an occasion or making any use of conventional versification. It is, frankly, sentimental. It is burdened with cliches. But yet, in spite of that, I think that the poem has some redeeming qualities that we want to celebrate. So let's now go to the poem. Now again, it's a three-part poem. We'll deal with all three parts together. And notice we'll start with the title, The Singer. You'll remember that Song of the Rolling Earth, Part 2. The song is to the singer and comes back most to him. I think there's some of that idea going on here. Now, we've already commented on the ways in which Whitman himself always wants to paint himself as a singer, a bard, and here we're going to have a different kind of singer. Now we're going to have this interesting moment when a operetta is able to show up, a musician is able to show up at a prison and to sing. For those of you that maybe have seen, for example, the film about Johnny Cash, Walk the Line, and the way that that film opens, you'll have some sense already at this of this idea at 3A. Now to the first section. O sight of pity, shame, and dole, O fearful thought, a convict soul. The same two lines will begin and end the poem. You'll remember this word convict from, again, when we meet it at You Felons on Trial in Court. So we'll come back to this idea of the convict. Now to the poem. Rang the refrain along the hall, the prison, again, this is 1869 Sing Sing Prison, New York. Rose to the roof, the vaults of heaven above, pouring in floods of melody, in tones so pensive, sweet, and strong, the like whereof was never heard. We're going to see a lot of hyperbole in this poem. Reaching the far-off sentry and the armed guards, who ceased their pacing, making the hearers' pulses stop, more hyperbole, for ecstasy and awe. You'll remember this word awe for the first time used in beginning my studies in the inscription section. Now, I want to point out something interesting. In this poem, you have kind of a setting that is created where you have these prisoners, convicts, who are there being gathered on a Sunday for a service, and this woman is going to be brought in to sing. And I want to point out the power of this idea of the caged bird. We're going to actually finish with Dunbar's classic poem, Sympathy, and Maya Angelou's title of her autobiography, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. I think some of that is played out here in this poem, part two. The sun was low in the west one winter day. By the way, notice all the adjectives in this poem. When down a narrow aisle, amid the thieves and outlaws of the land, then in parenthetics, there by the hundred seated, sear-faced murderers, wily counterfeiters, gathered to Sunday church, in prison walls, the keepers round, plenteous, well-armed, watching with vigilant eyes, in parenthetics. So in other words, he's setting up the stage. Now, it is true. This is kind of an unusual poem for Leaves of Grass. We haven't seen a lot of this where he's just describing something that apparently he himself was a witness to this performance. Calmly, a lady walked holding. This is, of course, Pepira Rosa, one of the great operettas of Whitman's day. Calmly, a lady walked, holding a little innocent child by either hand. So in other words, so she walks in with children as she comes in. So you can kind of see the imagery here is compelling, right? So you got these really pretty hardened criminals, convicts and criminals, and then you've got this woman who walks in astride two children, innocent children, whom, sitting on their stools beside her on the platform, she, first preluding with the instrument, a low and musical prelude, in voice surpassing all, sang forth a quaint old hymn. Now, we're going to get the hymn itself, and again, this is a little bit out of character for Whitman. We saw this with O Captain, My Captain. Notice the last words, bands, hands, breast, rest. You see it? A, B, B, and then fro, woe, face, grace. So you can see the rhyme scheme that's being played here. A soul confided by bars and bands cries, help, oh help, and wrings her hands. Blinded her eyes, bleeding her breast, nor pardon finds, nor balm of rest. Ceaseless she paces to and fro, O heart-sick days, O nights of woe. Nor hand of friend, nor loving face, nor favor comes, nor word of grace. It was not I that sinned the sin, the ruthless body dragged me in. Of course, this distinction, we've seen it many times, Song of Myself, passage 48, that tension between body and soul. Though long I strove courageously, the body was too much for me. Dear prison soul, bear up a space, for soon or late the certain grace to set thee free and bear thee home, the heavenly pardoner, death shall come. And then back to italics, convict no more, nor shame nor dole, depart a God enfranchised soul. This idea of salvation, in other words, all right? And then part three now is the after effects. And I think one of the things Whitman's doing here, and this is very subtle, and I think this is one of the reasons why it's in Autumn Rivulets, is this idea of rebirth, this idea that art has this capacity to take you from where you are and to take you or transport you somewhere else. Watch passage three. The singer ceased. One glance swept from her clear, calm eyes, notice the repetition of the C sounds, or all those upturned faces, strange sea of prison faces, a thousand varied. And again, the use of numbers, thousands, he loves this. We've seen this so many times in Leaves of Grass. Of course, varied takes us back to I Hear America Singing the Varied Carols I Hear. A thousand varied, crafty, earlier it was wily, right? Brutal, seamed, and beauteous faces. It's interesting, again, he's going to get both sides of that, you know, yin-yang symbol, if you will. Then, rising, passing back along the narrow aisle between them, while her gown touched them, rustling in the silence. This takes us, and readers of Whitman's day would immediately go to the Mark 5 passage in Mark 5, 21 through 34, where Christ is touched by a woman who has some kind of issue. The very idea of just being able to touch Christ will give some kind of special type of medicinal quality, playing that kind of game. She vanished with her children in the dusk. Again, notice the power of coloration in this poem. While, now what's left, obviously in the hall alone, while upon all convicts and armed keepers ere they stirred. So notice now, they're joined together, the convicts and the guards. Notice parenthetics. Convict forgetting prison, keeper his loaded pistol, in parenthetics. It's fascinating. What are we saying? Well, great art somehow helps the observer, the listener, the participant, to be transported, right, to another mental place, to another spiritual place. It somehow even almost transposes, right? A hush and pause fell down a wondrous minute with deep, half-stifled sobs and sound of bad men bowed and moved to weeping and youth's convulsive breathings, memories of home. And we could make the argument that this idea of reminiscence, which will be the word that gets used two lines later, we're going to pick up with it with the next poem in Warble for Lilaca. This idea of memories and memories of home. If you'll think about it, in Autumn Rivulets, we've seen this already quite a bit. A child went forth comes to mind immediately. What are these memories of home? The mother's voice in lullaby, the sister's care, the happy childhood. In other words, what is it that Whitman wants all of his readers to remember? That for every terrible convict that is a man, they were once a young child. And if only they could have been possibly treated better, raised better, educated better, they might not end up here. Of course, notice how art here is a form of education, this woman coming in to sing and thereby to educate. The long-pent spirit roused to reminiscence. And here we are again. Notice the convict earlier is going to forget the prison and the keeper his loaded pistol. But now we're back to reminiscence. A wondrous minute then. We're back to the wondrous minute of a few lines above. Notice the use of the dash. But after, in the solitary night, to many, many there, years after, even in the hour of death, the sad refrain, the tune, the voice, the words resumed. The large, calm lady walks the narrow aisle, the wailing melody again. The singer in the prison sings, and then the words we started with, O sight of beauty, O sight of pity, shame and dole, O fearful thought, a convict soul. And again, the use of the dash in that line. Well, what are we going to say about a poem like this in 2A? Well, I think the argument that Whitman is making is that great art can somehow transcend time and place, which is why I think he keeps using that phrase, time and place, and allows for the listener, the hearer, the observer, the participant, to be transported, to somehow be revived, we might even say. At 2B, well, there are a lot of readers that dislike this poem because of its sentimentality, and yet I think that Whitman's trying to make a point, and again, it's part of his sustained theodicy. Even in the worst imaginable condition, we can learn to ask, why did this happen for me? And great art often will help that to happen. At 3A, I mentioned it already. A few years later, in 1899, Paul Laurence Dunbar, one of our great, great poets, would write the poem Sympathy that would have so much influence on the great Maya Angelou. And of course, she would name her autobiography, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. That's the 1969 offering. Let's just enjoy this poem as it relates to the poem that we just read. I know, Sympathy by Dunbar, I know what the caged bird feels, alas, when the sun is bright on the upland slopes, when the wind stirs soft through the springing grass and the river flows like a stream of glass, when the first bird sings and the first bud opes and the faint perfume from its chalice steals, I know what the caged bird feels. I know why the caged bird beat his wings till its blood is red on the cruel bars, for he must fly back to his perch and cling where he fain would be on the bough a swing, and a pain still throbs in the old, old scars, and they pulse again with a keener sting. I know why he beats his wing. I know why the caged bird sings, ah me, when his wing is bruised and his bosom sore, when he beats his bars and he would be free. It is not a carol of joy or glee, but a prayer that he sends from his heart's deep core, but a plea that upward to heaven he flings. I know why the caged bird sings. I think that we're playing a very similar game, obviously, in this, that you've got these caged humans who somehow for a brief moment in time are allowed to kind of have that time suspended in this powerful moment of this beautiful operatic art. And it's going to transport them back to where? Well, back to their time of innocence, back to that age of innocence, right? Finally, at 3B, how are we going to own a poem like this? Well, I think it's pretty easy to ask a question like this. What was a time that a tune moved you and it took you back? And what is your favorite tune for that to happen? And of course, we could point out that maybe for some of us, Leaves of Grass continues to kind of do this as well. Thank you.